everyone, and welcome to the Void Theater. As always, I'm your host, Alexander. So, there's not much going on in terms of shows right now. I mean, we got the new BM Puppycat, which I might review later, but outside of that, there's really only Little Demon and the upcoming or just released Cyberpunk show. So I thought with it being Cartoon Network's 30th anniversary, I would take the time and talk about movies. But more specifically, the old Cartoon Network animated movies that a bunch of the cartoons had back in the day. And I wanted to find out what was the best of the best. So, let's do that. Now, as always, with stuff like this, there are always going to be some rules that we have to follow. Rule 1. This is a list of animated movies specifically for the Cartoon Network television series, so none of the weird Marvel movies that they tried to push way back in the day. Rule 2. No series finales or series premieres bundled together count as movies. So things like the Samurai Jack premiere movie, Foster's House of Blue, and Operation Interviews don't count. Rule 3. I'm basing the criteria on the movie's animation, its plot, and its overall connection to the series. Rule 4. Obviously, these are all my opinion, and as such, you are free and encouraged to disagree with them. There's no real wrong answer here. And finally, Rule 5. And this might be controversial, but I've decided to not count the DC movies. As popular as they are, I'm only counting movies made for Cartoon Network, and both Batman and Batman Beyond were made for Kids WB and later brought over to Cartoon Network. Also, I want this to be a fair fight, and if we're being honest, none of the movies on this list come close to something like Mask of the Phantasm. But in the interest of fairness, I will give some quick ratings on them. So, starting off, Batman Mask of the Phantasm is a 9 out of 10. This is one of the definitive Batman movies. Like the show it's based off of, it set the groundwork for Batman for years to come, and it frankly hasn't been topped in live action or animation. Second, Batman Beyond, Return of the Joker, an 8.5 out of 10. Like the show that came before, Batman Beyond was one of the crucial shows for the Batman mythos, and this movie is a perfect companion for the show and gives us one of the most gruesome scenes in the DC animated universe history. The entire torture scene with Tim Drake is one of the most brutal things on TV, and it was only made worse when you realize it was a child being tortured. And while the movie does stumble with some odd twists and turns in it that prevent it from being on the same level as Mask of the Phantasm, it's still overall a great movie and one of the best animated DC movies ever. Next up is Teen Titans Trouble in Tokyo. It's a 7 out of 10. This one is kinda weird. It's meant to be a series finale, but there's not much to actually tie it to the main story. The concept is interesting and the mystery behind it is solid, but outside of that, there's really just not much to it. But unlike the last two I just talked about, if you haven't seen the show, you probably wouldn't care as much about it. And all the Teen Titans Go movies are around a 7.5 out of 10. I know that seems kinda lazy, but it's hard to give them a real solid rating. Realistically, you're not watching these for the plot, so it'd be weird to focus on that. But the humor, like the humor in the show, is really hit or miss. I would say just turn your brain off and enjoy it for what it is. But now that we have the honorable mentions out of the way, we can begin. So without further ado, let's raise the curtain and put these movies on stage. Alright, so we'll go down the list chronologically, and that starts with Dexter's Lab, Ego Trip. I gotta be honest, I thought I made this movie up. I had vague memories of watching it as a kid, but I thought I just imagined it. Only to find out that it is a real movie, but for some reason the movie has only ever aired 3 times. Once in December 1999, the second being the following New Year's, and then apparently there was a rerun in 2010. By the way, I'm not doing this for every movie, but I really just wanted to sell how weird the release of this movie is. Anyway, the general plot is that Dexter travels in time to see his future selves after he's mistakenly told that he's the one who will save the future. Along the way, he meets 3 different versions of himself. A weak nerd, a senile old man, and an action hero. Together they face off against the 4 versions of Mandark and win. Then they find out it was Dee Dee who saved the future by pushing a button, making Dexter angry enough to send the robots from the beginning back in time to try and kill his sister, thus creating a paradox. Okay, so let's start with the plot. Because while I did skim over some details, the truth is it's not insanely complicated, and that's not really a bad thing. We'll see later in the video, but there's no real need to try and stretch a concept like Dexter's Lab to its limits. The overall movie is 45 minutes and the average episode was around 15. The plot works well because it's just enough to get you from point A to point B without any unnecessary fat in between it. As for the animation, it looks like the show did with more polish and the humor is pretty much the same. If you watch Dexter's Lab as a child, you're going to go into this knowing what to expect. Nothing's going to surprise you, but you won't be disappointed either. I know it seems like I'm being tough on this movie, but the truth is that for Cartoon Network's first attempt at a movie, it's good. It's just you can feel the writers wanted to play it safe. You'll start to notice that later on the movie starts to drift away from that concept, but overall, it's a solid movie. It's a perfectly serviceable 7 out of 10. If it were one of the newer movies, I would probably rank it lower, but for a first attempt at a TV movie and an attempted series finale before the revival, I can't really be too hard on it. Next up, however, is the Flintstones movie, On the Rocks. yet again another movie I had no idea existed before making this list, and like Ego Trip, is a near lost piece of media. Except unlike that movie, this one was never released on any sort of video, though you can still find it online. And just to be upfront here, it's a 6.5 out of 10. This is a weird movie. First off, the entire film is supposed to be a far more adult-themed video, and the humor kind of reflects that. It's a lot of adult jokes and more mature sense of humor. It feels a lot like early Family Guy. Not overly vulgar, but you'll notice the difference between the show and the movie. As for the plot, it's a basic story about Wilma and Fred trying to fix their marriage while a thief tries to get a diamond back from Wilma. Like Ego Trip, nothing here is spectacular, but I will say that the humor, while a little dated, is still pretty funny. The jokes are still solid and most of the punchlines still work. There's not much to say about the animation because it looks the same, though that may be because I couldn't find a high quality version of the movie. But I enjoyed what I saw regardless. Otherwise, let's move on to the next one, and for once it's a movie I do know, the Powerpuff Girls movie. Now, this is where Cartoon Network got really serious about their movies. This was their first real attempt in trying theatrical releases, and them realizing that spectacles like this meant they could go all out. And it shows here. The first thing you're going to notice is that the animation is way more refined than the stuff in the show. It's cleaner and the colors are far more vibrant. As for the plot, the entire movie is meant to serve as a prequel to the actual series and shows the girls before they became heroes and the rise of Mojo Jojo. Like with the first two on this list, the plot isn't exceptionally complicated, but in this context, it fits. See, while we're given the idea of how the Powerpuff Girls were made in the opening, a lot of the villains' origin stories are left fairly vague. And while you don't need an explanation for a show like this, it's always fun to see the beginning of characters. And for the Powerpuff Girls, it works well because they had a sizable list of characters to choose from. I will admit that while I know Mojo was the pick, I don't think he was the most interesting, and the movie kind of suffers because it doesn't really feel like he can carry it for its entire 73-minute runtime. But that being said, for their first real attempt at a bigger production and actual theatrical release, it's well worth watching if you've never seen the movie. It still holds up surprisingly well despite the issues I have with it. I'm gonna give the movie a 7.5 out of 10. Flawed, but still fun. Next up is Codename Kids Next Door, Operation Zero. Okay, I'm really excited for this one. This is easily one of my favorite movies on the list, but that being said, it's not without its faults, and I intend to try and be as unbiased as possible. So let's start with the plot. The main story focuses on the long-lost legend of Number Zero, a Kids Next Door operative who stopped the reign of Grandfather, the father of the main series villain Father, and subsequently faded into legend. That is, until Father brings Grandfather back and forces Number One to try and hunt down Zero for his help. He finds him, and together they stop Grandfather and save both the Kids Next Door and the world. Okay, so let's talk villains here for a minute, because there's a reason I put Grandfather in the thumbnail. He's a perfect example of a movie villain. He's a character completely tied to the movie and he never reappears, but he still manages to be one of the best characters in the movie. I also want to give a shout out to Father, who, while not being a major villain in this, is still really fun to see in this movie. Okay, now that I've got that out of the way, let's address the actual movie. Starting off, the plot is solid. I like the background into how long the Kids Next Door have been around, I think Zero himself is an interesting concept as a whole, and the movie does a good job of keeping him front and center while also giving everyone else a chance to shine. The comedy and action in this movie are the same as the show, and that's fine. The show was an action comedy to begin with, so all they really had to do was make it work for a longer duration. But it did also give us one of the best father moments in the show's runtime, so I'm gonna give it bonus points for that.
Why don't you give it up? Now, Monty, I'm only thinking of our heritage.
You
came to bed.
Now you've made me very, very, very.
Yeah, get it. You can wrestle with Pappy yourself, Monty. I'm going to get some Rocky Road.
Then you get to the animation, and it's definitely from the early 2000s. The 2D animation looks good, but a lot of the 3D shots have that we just figured out CGI and now we're going to use it vibe. But so far, the movie holds the highest rating, sitting comfortably at an 8.5 out of 10. If you've never seen Operation Zero, go watch it. It's on HBO Max and it's well worth the money. Also, apparently Father is a child kidnapper. I don't have a reason for saying that, but I gotta fit that in because the movie seems to make a big deal out of it and then completely ignore it.
Wrong! You mean something went terribly right! My first delightfulization chamber blew a fuse, increasing its power 11 billion fold! I lost the machine, but gained 5 perfect delightful children!
Next on the list is Good Will Hunting, the first of the two movies from Fosters. Now, you could make the argument that technically speaking, it's not a television movie so much as it is a television special. It's actually one of the shortest on the list, just barely under Ego Trip at just 44 minutes. But I would also say that it's one of the best. While nothing in the animation or humor really changes, the strength of this lies in the plot. It follows Wilt traveling across the country trying to atone for a mistake he made with his creator. The plot is quick and painless, but despite being so simple, it holds together really well. There's also some well-done jokes with the other imaginary friend's creators, and we get some explanation for why Wilt is the way he is. I also like how this movie ties into another Foster short about Wilt desperately trying to watch a basketball game and becoming more and more obsessed about it. So despite not really doing anything outside the box, I'm going to give Good Will Hunting a 7.5 out of 10. It may be simple, but simple is good when there's heart behind it, and this movie has a ton of heart. Moving on, we have two movies I'm going to kind of breeze past, because while they are movies, they really only count in the broadest terms. So to save everyone some time, I'm just going to cover both of them and kind of make it a quick read. Those being My Gym Partner's a Monkey, The Big Field Trip, and Camp Lazlo, Where's Lazlo? Okay, so both of these are pretty much just extended episodes of the original shows. The animation and the humor are exactly the same as the show. As for the plot, The Big Field Trip focuses on all the animals of Charles Darwin taking a big field trip to a literal field. They get lost along the way and have to find a way to get there. As for Where's Lazlo, it tells the story of how Lazlo met Raj and Clam at the camp. You know, looking at this list, there's a lot of these movies that tend to fall into the origin story scenario. It's really weird that no one wants to break outside this box. Anyway, like The Big Field Trip, the plotline is simple and the animation isn't too different from the original show, which firmly lands Where's Lazlo with a 4.5 out of 10 and The Big Field Trip at a 5 out of 10, only due to the fact that the humor is just slightly better. Up next, we have the first Billy and Mandy movie with Big Boogie Adventure. Now, this is a cult classic Cartoon Network movie, and chances are if you were watching TV in the early 2000s, you probably know this movie by heart. The movie aired constantly on TV, mainly due to the popularity of the show at the time, and also because the movie received substantially favorable reviews when it came out. And for a good reason. Billy and Mandy was one of those few cartoon shows to air that knew the rules of gross-out humor, and they knew it well.
That wasn't the gift, that was this morning's three cheese omelet. Fear the Gouda.
The comedy in this movie is fantastic, and it holds up surprisingly well. There are a few dated pop culture references, but overall, you should still understand most of the references in the movie. There's even a cameo from The Kids Next Door in it. As for the animation, it's solid and well polished. The show's vibrant colors are still there, and they look good here. The plot for the movie is actually one of the better ones so far on the list. Grim is being put on trial to see if he can continue to be the Grim Reaper, while Boogie uses the opportunity to try and get an item known as Horror's Hand, an object that forces people to see their worst fear. It then becomes a race against time, with everyone eventually ending up at Horror's Hand, and it's Grim who gets it due to having his worst fear every day by living with Billy and Mandy. The movie ends with Grim becoming the Reaper again and locking up the hand in his trunk. Like I said, the plot here is actually one of the stronger ones on the list. It doesn't have any real connection to any of the series, but because it doesn't, you can just sit back and enjoy it for what it is. It's also one of the few movies on this list where it feels like the idea was created first, and then they realized they had a movie idea already, rather than make a movie and fill in the blanks as they went along. Overall, Billy and Mandy is right up there as one of the best Cartoon Network movies so far, sitting at a very high 9 out of 10. It's dumb gross-out humor, but it's gross-out humor that knows it's dumb gross-out humor, and it makes it work in the best possible way. Then, we have the second Billy and Mandy movie, which is The Wrath of the Spider Queen. This one lacks the spectacle that the previous movie had, but it's still a fun one. The plot focuses on one of Grimm's old classmates from his high school that has come back to take revenge on him for stealing the title of Grim Reaper because she believed he cheated to get it. She also plans on marrying Jeff, Billy's spider son. After taking over all of Ennsville, she forces Grimm to relive their meeting and the events leading up to the Reaper contest that would have determined who got the job. In the end, Mandy and Grimm explain that Grimm didn't cheat and that it was actually Boogie who was attempting to stuff the ballot box. Grimm only won because he snapped and used a scythe to punish him. Forgiving her friend, Velma then decides to just conquer the planet instead. So, I made a lot of compliments about Big Boogie's adventures, and they still apply here. The humor is crass and on point, the animation looks fine, and despite being a sort of prequel to the show, I actually really liked this plotline. And I really enjoyed the concept of the Spider Queen. She was a really well-designed and thought-out villain, and it's one of the strengths this movie has over Big Boogie's adventure. In that movie, the main villain was Boogie, who, while entertaining, doesn't really work as a villain, but more like a punching bag for the characters to beat on. But here, Velma actually shines as a truly sympathetic villain. She didn't know that Grimm was trying to make sure she won, she just assumed he cheated for his own benefit. There's also a lot of really funny interactions between Billy and Jeff, who gets a major part in this movie. Overall, while Wrath of the Spider Queen doesn't compare to what Big Boogie Adventure was, it definitely succeeds in its own right. It's a far shorter, more condensed movie than the other, but I think that for the story they're trying to tell, it works extremely well, mainly due to having a lovable villain and some really good character interactions. So I'm going to give it a 7 out of 10. But now we move on to the first of the three Ben 10 movies on the list. Ben 10, Secret of the Omnitrix. And it's a fun movie. I think out of all of the Ben 10 movies that have come out, this is probably my favorite. Also, fun fact, this movie apparently has three different versions with three different opening aliens. This movie also started the trend of each movie introducing new aliens in them. But the main plot of this one revolves around the Omnitrix, which is set to explode once the detonation is stopped by its creator. Now, in regards to the plot, I really like this one. Like a lot of the other movies, it's basic, but the idea that Ben never knew everything about the watch, and so it could do anything it wanted to, was an interesting idea that I'm glad they explored in the first movie. This is also the first time we see Azmuth, and it answers the question of who created the Omnitrix and gives a good reason on why he would even build it in the first place. I also like that the self-destruct sequence was meant to stop anyone who would have wanted to turn it into a weapon, like a 10-foot-tall squid monster from space. But overall, the movie is fun. There are some decent action scenes, and seeing the new reveal of the aliens was always interesting. Overall, I'll probably give Secret of the Omnitrix a 7.5 out of 10. The plot is good, the new aliens are fun, and the reveal of the creator of the Omnitrix was a well-done revelation. The only thing I could really fault the movie for is for keeping it close to the show, but like most of the movies on the list, that's kind of the point. When you look at their production number, they're usually meant to be season openers or some sort of filler in between seasons. So with something like this, it makes sense why they wouldn't want to go too hard in a change in the art style or do anything too crazy. Though with that being said, we'll still be covering another Ben 10 movie later down the line, which does do some more drastic things. But yeah, for now, Ben 10 Secret of the Omnitrix sits at a solid 7.5 out of 10. Next on the list is Foster's Home for Imaginary Friends, Destination Imagination. So this one falls into the list of movies I know I've seen at least once, but if you were to ask me, I couldn't have told you what I remembered about it until I resaw it. But rewatching it, I actually found myself enjoying it a lot more than I thought I would. The story for it is surprisingly well made, and the main villain World is an interesting and a pretty sympathetic villain. The general story is that World and his toy box are left at Foster's, and Frankie, feeling unappreciative for all her hard work, climbs into it and quickly becomes friends with World, who gives her everything she could ever want in hopes of being her friend and keeping her there. The other imaginary friends then realize she's gone and hop into the toy box to find her. Eventually they do, and they bring her and World out and back to Foster's. Now, like I said earlier, I'm abridging these movies to keep the flow going, but honestly, the plot for this one is actually really solid. The main focus of the movie isn't so much about World as a villain, but more about the concept of being underappreciated and loneliness. But World himself is a rather interesting character, and really cool in terms of an imaginary friend design. But I think the best moment of this movie comes at the end with the payoff between Mr. Harriman and Frankie.
I have known you since you were a little girl. And as I've watched you grow, I've been absolutely amazed by your lack of maturity, your laziness, and your lack of judgment.
Good grief, this again? Mr. Harriman!
And all that time, I was wrong. If Miss Francis thinks allowing the imaginary friend into the house is a good idea, I trust her judgment. I said move it!
The ending is this really sweet moment with him acknowledging all the things she does around the house and admitting that she's always been a good judge of character when it comes to imaginary friends. It's one of those rare moments in the show where you get the feeling that Harriman does see Frankie in the same way he sees Madame Foster. It's really just a generational gap that makes it hard for them to understand each other. Honestly, watching this movie, I felt like it held up better than Good Will Hunting simply because a lot of people can relate to the topics like wanting to have a friend and wanting to escape your job even if it's only for a few minutes at a time. Overall, the movie is fun and heartwarming. Definitely one of the highlights in the list, and if you haven't seen it, it's on HBO Max. I'd recommend giving it a watch. I give Destination Imagination an 8.5 out of 10. Okay, so I've been avoiding talking about this one, but I'm gonna say something controversial here, and it needs to be said. Ed and Eddy's Big Picture Show is not that great of a movie. It's not bad, not by a long shot. Honestly, it's one of the better Cartoon Network TV finales. But real quick, do you remember how long this movie is? Because before I rewatched it for this video, I always thought it was around 2.5 to 3 hours long. It's 1.5 hours long. And that's a major issue, because the general idea for the movie seems solid. The Eds have to leave the cul-de-sac after their biggest scam ever goes wrong, and they try and find Eddie's brother. But the issue is that this could have worked for 1/2 hour or maybe even 1 full hour, but trying to give it a full feature-length movie to that one idea is just too much. Ed, Edd n Eddy, like Dexter, worked better because the ideas for each episode were usually self-contained in the 15-minute runtime. But unlike Ego Trip, where it extended it slightly, taking the base concept of Ed, Edd n Eddy doesn't really work in the format of a movie. That being said, the movie does have some genuinely good moments, and virtually all of the cast get a decent amount of screen time and some really good jokes. Kevin and Naz really shine in their parts, and seeing Ed, and Eddie traveling as they try to find some way to fix the mess they made was enjoyable. The animation is clean and feels just like a higher quality version of the show, and of course the movie finally gave us the appearance of Eddie's brother, who is just a grade A certified asshole. Honestly, I really do like this movie. It's really just the length that stopped this from being an instant rewatch. But despite my grievances with it, I'd still recommend this movie to anyone that watched the original but never got a chance to see it. The entire movie feels like a love letter to a show that defined the 90s, and the movie itself feels like saying goodbye to characters you grew up with as a kid. It definitely goes on for way longer than it should, but that's because it wants it to be a definitive ending for the series. So, with all that being said, I'm going to give Ed and Eddy's Big Picture Show an 8 out of 10. It's long, but when you know what they're trying to do with it, you don't mind the length. It just gets a little exhausting. But now that we've crossed that off the list, let's finish off the original Ben 10 series with their second movie, and the only CGI movie on the list, Ben 10 Destroy All Aliens. Okay, so let's start with the CGI. Despite the time this came out, it's actually really good. I don't think it's fair to compare it to modern stuff, but overall, it holds up reasonably well. The characters come off a little smooth and shiny at times, but I didn't hate that they were trying a new art style to test the waters. As for the plot, it follows the Tennyson team as they try to fix a glitch in the Omnitrix and outrun an alien seeking to destroy Ben. A very common trope for all these movies. But despite that sounding really similar to the first movie, this one serves as more of an expansion on certain themes in that one. We get to see more of Azmuth's family, and there are even some teasers of Gwen's developing powers that are revealed later in Alien Force. It's small things, but I think the consistency to use the movies to explain things is a smart idea. All things considered, I do like this movie. I think that it presents a much more interesting idea over the first movie, and it's one of the few times in a Ben 10 movie where Vilgax isn't the main threat. It's nice to see other villains and evil aliens, especially because the Ben 10 universe has never been shy about the idea that there are a lot of evil alien races out in the universe. There are also a few twists in the movie that, while a little weird, are definitely fun. If I did have one complaint, though, it would be that this movie has a lot less impact than the first. And that's mainly due to the fact that, unlike Secret of the Omnitrix, most of the new characters here don't make repeat appearances later in the series. So whatever they do here is kind of what they're left with. It's not bad, but it can drag it down a bit. But it's a rather small detail in an otherwise okay movie. So I'm going to give Ben 10 Destroy All Aliens a 7 out of 10. Fun fact, until the reboot movie, this was the last Ben 10 animated movie to come out. But now, we reach into the tail end of the list and move into the final four, starting with regular show, the movie. You know, it's funny, way back when the Renaissance hit, this was one of the more hyped movies people always thought about. It was this, an Adventure Time movie, a Gumball movie, and a Steven Universe movie. I mean, we got 2 out of 4, that's not bad, right? Because we're probably not getting Gumball anymore. Anyway, this is the second time travel movie on the list, which is kind of surprising. I feel like time travel movies feel like the easy way out in this scenario. But the main story focuses on Mordecai and Rigby traveling through time to stop their old teacher and a future Mordecai from destroying everything and also save their friendship. A weird plot for any other show, but a pretty standard one for a regular show. I really don't have anything to say about the plot. It's so out there that you really have to see it for itself. But remember when I said that the Big Picture Show didn't work because it went on for too long without having a plot to back it up? Well, Regular Show the movie feels like the correction to that mistake. The movie is about 1 hour and 7 minutes long, but it doesn't feel like it goes on forever. And I think that's because Regular Show had the added benefit of knowing how to handle longer episodes. The show was always having special 30-minute episodes that had overarching plot lines, so when the time came to make a movie, they knew how to handle it. But as for the general design of the movie, it's well done. While the style is still the same as the show, there are definitely certain scenes in the movie that you can tell were given far more time and effort and care than a typical episode, while also mixing in some really well-done CGI. I'll also say that for the people who have watched the show, you'll notice the tone is a bit more in line with the later seasons. It's more so season 8 where the comedy took a backseat to the storyline. But the jokes are still here, and I still got a lot of chuckles out of it. I also want to say that the soundtrack for the movie is great. There are actually a few good songs that fit in tune with the show's overarching themes. All that being said, I'm going to give Regular Show the movie an 8.5 out of 10. It's a crazy movie, but it comes from a crazy show that knows how to make that insanity work, the same way Billy and Mandy makes gross-out humor work. Okay, folks, we've got 3 more left and we're in the tail end, so let's talk about Steven Universe, the movie. Look, I understand that Steven Universe is a controversial show. I get that. Even ignoring the obvious and sometimes stupid reason people might find the show controversial, the show itself was always weird when it came to handling plot lines and character arcs. Look up a video on the Diamond Redemption arc and you'll find enough videos to fill your entire day with content. I bring that up because while Season 5 and Future were sometimes pretty hit and miss with how they handle things, Steven Universe the movie is easily one of the best things to come out of the show. This movie is what I feel a lot of people wanted Future to be. The plot follows Spinel, a forgotten gem and a toy of Pink Diamond, as she comes to Earth and tries to kill the crystal gems. It's a simple plotline that's both the setup of future and the payoff of the five seasons of seeing Steven's growth and watching him come to terms with who his mother really was. But the real star of the movie here is Spinel, who despite this being her first appearance, quickly became one of the most recognizable gems in the show, to the point that even her songs were hitting the top spots on people's personal tier lists. And it's not hard to see why. Besides her amazing design and her fluid animations, the truth is, Spinel is just a perfectly fun and sympathetic villain. You genuinely feel bad for her once you know her story, but you also understand that she's directing her anger at the wrong people. Even then, when she does join the other gems, it's not an instant forgiveness. She tries to adjust and struggles at the end of the movie, and it even continues on into future. The point is, she feels real. Now look, am I going to argue that Steven Universe didn't have its faults? No. Anyone who watched the show could have found something they didn't like about it. That doesn't make it a bad show, just one that misses the mark sometimes. But I will say there's a reason why Spinel is one of the most requested Steven Universe representatives for multiverses, and 90% of that is because of this movie. It handles her so well, and it handles the entire plot of itself so well, you can't help but want to rewatch this. It's one of the few movies I actually have a DVD of, just because when I first saw it online, I immediately wanted to own it. Which is why I'm giving Steven Universe the movie a 9.5 out of 10. It's a movie that feels nearly flawless and somehow felt better than the post-show continuation that came after it. Alright, final two. So let's talk about We Bare Bears, the movie. These movie titles got really lazy later on. Anyway, this one is kind of a hybrid film. It shows the bears first meeting each other like a prequel, but it also canonically ends the series of We Bare Bears. The general plot is that the bears have finally caused enough chaos in the city to finally have them forcibly relocated to a nature preserve far away from their friends. When the bears escape this, the wildlife officer in charge of the operations, Agent Trout, a human supremacist who believes in the segregation of animals and humans, tries to have them forcibly removed to their respective climates. Asia for Panda, the Arctic for Ice Bear, and a standard nature reserve for Grizz. When that fails, he instead just tries to murder them in a wildfire. He fails, and the bears are returned home where the series ends. What the fuck happened in this movie? So, there's a lot to break down there, but it's a very weirdly heavy movie. And I actually like it for that. It takes an insane amount of courage to attempt something like this, especially in a movie for younger audiences, but it pays off. The movie is dark. I don't think anyone can argue that, but it's also heartwarming to see how much the bears will risk for each other despite being so-called mindless animals. And Trout is an unapologetically evil human being, with some not-so-subtle allegories to hate groups. Like I said, this movie is heavy, but it doesn't beat around the bush with what it's trying to say. It's clear that the creators, writers, and showrunners had a definitive idea for what they wanted the movie to be, and that they were determined to see it through one way or another. Like with most of these, the animation is good, it's a polished version of the style the show had, but I've gotta be honest, as someone who only infrequently watched the show, this movie surprised me in the best way possible. It's a heartwarming tale of family and acceptance, and it actually made me want to go back and rewatch the series. So with all that being said, I'm gonna give We Bare Bears the movie a solid 9 out of 10. I genuinely never paid attention to this movie, and I feel like I did the creator a huge disservice by it. Alright, final movie. So, let's wrap it up with the Ben 10 reboot movie, Ben 10 vs. the Universe, the movie. That is a hell of a title right there, isn't it? And I feel like I probably should have switched these around, because this movie didn't really wow me. In terms of art design, it looks fine, the style takes some getting used to, but once you're used to it, it's no big deal. The main problem really lies in the plot. The movie feels like they recycled Secret of the Omnitrix and added just a bit more to it. I like how they handled Kevin, the idea of making him this tinkerer is a cool idea on the surface, and giving him his own bootleg Omnitrix is a fun idea. Even the backstory of making Vilgax an apprentice to Azmuth is cool in concept, but otherwise I can't really find anything about the movie that really grips me. I don't think that's the movie's fault though. I mean, let's face it, Ben 10 at this point is the Pokemon of Cartoon Network. It's been around for so long and it's been redone so many times, you're eventually bound to stall on ideas for it. Like I said, the movie isn't bad, but it doesn't wow me. So, I'm just gonna give Ben 10 vs. the Universe the movie a 6.5 out of 10. I wish this had been more, because I don't hate the Ben 10 reboot series. I think it's fine, but this isn't really anything. Now, normally I would wrap it up here, but I want to do something fun. So I'm gonna give out some bonus points. Think of them like the pity stars from Mario Party. Each bonus point will be worth 1 point to the final score of the movie. Some of the lower ones may not win first place, but at the very least they can have some extra credit. So first up, we have Best Soundtrack. and let's be honest, this one is going to be Steven Universe. Though I will say that Regular Show the Movie was a close second option. Next up is Best Art Design, and I'm going to give it to Ben 10 Destroy All Aliens. It may not have been the best CGI in the world, but I can respect the fact that there was an honest attempt to try something out of the comfort zone. And for the most part, everyone in the movie does look solid in the 3D style. It's a little rough, but it is well done. Next up, we have Best Comedy. And Big Boogie Adventure gets the bonus point on this one. This movie had some genuinely funny moments, and even rewatching it, I still laughed when I saw it. Next up is a more specific category, but Best Finale. And there aren't a lot of movies for this one, but I think Ed, Edd n Eddy Big Picture Show takes this. Look, despite my issues with the movie's runtime, I'm not going to deny how impactful a finale this was to one of the Cartoon Network greats. Second to last is Best Action, and I'm going to give this to Operation Zero. While it doesn't have the most fighting scenes out of all the movies, the scenes it does have are insanely well done. And finally, the last bonus point is connection to the series overall. And I'm going to give this one to Operation Zero as well. I'm giving it to Zero because while Steven Universe did have a connection to the story, it wasn't anything we didn't already know, it just expanded upon an idea that was already established. Whereas Zero introduced the concept of the Uno bloodline, the new Kids Next Door moon base, and the origin of the delightful children from down the lane. In the end, Operation Zero provided a lot more to the overall story than any other movie on this list. But now that we've tallied up the points, what is the best Cartoon Network movie? Well, coming in at third place is Ed, Edd n Eddy Big Picture Show with a solid 9 out of 10. Not surprising, that movie again, despite my issues with its runtime, is a cultural phenomenon and a cultural icon for Cartoon Network. Next up for the silver medal, we have Billy and Mandy's Big Boogie Adventure with a perfect 10 out of 10 thanks to that extra bonus point. There's a reason this movie is so iconic for Cartoon Network and a reason it airs so often. Honestly, it's just a good movie. It's arguably one of their best and I still think it holds up to this day. But the winner of the movies, in my own personal opinion, remind you, is a two-way tie between Steven Universe and Kids Next Door, tied at 10.5 out of 10. Yeah, I kind of went over the point system, but whatever, it's my video, I'm gonna do what I want. But the thing is, with these two movies, that's not really surprising for why they're so good. Both movies had fundamentally fantastic villains that built on the backstory of the show itself, and what they lack in certain areas compared to other movies on this list, they excel in other places. But for me, what really put these two above the rest is the fact that they can work as finales to their respective shows. If you watch Steven Universe the movie and stop after that, it actually has a pretty satisfying conclusion. You see Steven realize his work will never be done and there will always be gems to help, and he just has to accept that as part of his life. And with Operation Zero, it ends with number one's realization that he's not just the Kids Next Door by himself, but that every single operative that stands to fight against adult tyranny is just as much a valued member as he is to the organization. Both leave you with a satisfying conclusion to the series, even if the show was still ongoing. And that's what makes them great movies. They're good potential conclusions to the series, they work on their own, and they're also a bigger part of something greater. But with that, it's time for the current call for this Void Theater review of the best Cartoon Network movie. I hope you enjoyed this because this was probably my longest video and I have no desire to do this again for a very long time. Though I will say that it's interesting that Cartoon Network doesn't really have any genuinely bad movies. Even their worst ones are still passable. But as always, I'll leave you with some questions. What would you say is the best Cartoon Network movie? And would you want to see another video like this one in the same style for the other cartoon channels? Leave a comment down below and let me know what you want to see. And while you're down there, be sure to like the video and subscribe for more content. Until next time, I've been your host, Alexander, and I hope to see you back in my theater.